world is actively engaging in sequencing to trace the virus and to understand what is going on in the world right now. And as all of you know, even when a variant is found, it is now news headlines. So this is how much the general public are aware of different viral variants and even about sequencing. Now, just to understand why we need to do sequencing and why does the WHO recommend sequencing and what we can achieve. And of course, earlier when we started SARS-CoV-2 spreading everywhere in the world, it was because of to understand the origin of the virus. So if you got a strain in Sri Lanka, okay, where did it come from, who came from there, that sort of thing could be identified. That was when countries had their borders open. And of course with time now, this is a RNA virus and people didn't know how fast this virus was mutating. So certain viruses, RNA viruses mutate very fast, certain RNA viruses mutate slower, and as far as the SARS-CoV-2 goes, it is a relatively stable virus, but it still mutates around 2 mutations per month. So you can understand how long the virus, a particular virus has been around as well. And the other thing is to understand how you are controlling an outbreak or a pandemic. Now, in a community when a virus is spreading, when more and more people are getting infected, more and more viral variants emerge. So this is why we are seeing these various types of variants emerging in the UK, emerging in the South Africa. So if you talk about the South African strain to start with, about 50% of the population in those very socioeconomically deprived areas zero positive, in other words, had the infection. So the virus needs to infect more people, which means it needs to mutate in order to infect possibly the ones who have already got infection. So when you're not controlling epidemic properly, when more people are getting infections, you get more viral variants emerging. And also with time, the virus wants to spread faster, so it devises methods or the mutations that are associated with faster spread, a more rapid spread, emerge. And this is why we see certain types of mutations, viruses with faster spread emerging in UK and so many other countries. And so all of you just saw this curve and I'm sure you are very familiar with it. Let's see if I can get a point out. Okay, never mind. Now everything was very under control until all of us experienced this second wave, which is still ongoing, which was detected early October, but of course there is evidence that people had symptoms of illness from mid-September. So we wanted to see, so the question was for everybody, where did this virus come? And it became, it was discussed even in the parliament, so it became a political issue, where this virus came, was it the virus that was there, like for instance the Kandahar virus that had mutated and somehow re-emerged, or where did this virus come from? Okay, so this is just, I'm showing you the relationship between the current virus strain spreading everywhere, which is on the top, in relation to the Kandahar virus. Now, I'm sure most of you don't understand what this means, but this is sort of a family tree. You know, like in school, you draw father, mother, and their kids like related to each other. So this is what is known as a family tree. And as you can see, the Kandahar strain and the current virus strain don't seem to be from the same parents. It looks like a very different parents, as you can see, because they are very far apart, which sort of gave us evidence to say that it is unlikely to be the Kandahar strain, but some other strain emerged from elsewhere. And in order to make it easier to understand where strains come from, and this Pangolin website, so this is the global lineages of different viruses, and so you have names to different variants. So based on and the viruses are put in different, given different names or different names of the variant, so it's easier for people to track where the virus comes from. And when you say, like for instance, the UK variant, B.1.1.7, people understand, okay, this is this particular variant with these particular mutations and this has this type of infectivity and this side of recessivity, whether it evades vaccine or not. So by giving the variant a name, you understand all the things that associate with it. Infectivity, any diagnostic problems, whether it affects vaccine efficacy. So now I'm happy to say, so we have been sequencing throughout, but currently, very recently, our strain was given a new name. In other words, we have our own unique strain. So if you can just see, right at the bottom, Sri Lanka 100%. So this strain is exclusively strain in Sri Lanka. This our strain that emerged in early October is not seen, or late September, is not seen anywhere else, because the mutation seen and the other characteristics of the viral variant seen in Sri Lanka is unique to Sri Lanka, and it has been given this name of B.1.411. When we did a little bit of viral sequencing, they were not convinced whether it was a different variant or not. But when we did more sequencing and we submitted the data to the GISA, then because of the unique characteristics of our viral variant, we have a special name to our Sri Lankan variant. And you can see in the second year, I mean, unfortunately I can't show you, the most common country is Sri Lanka 100%. Okay, so it is only strain in Sri Lanka, and we have now got a variant. And if you look at this map, this the green is only highlighted in Sri Lanka, because this lineage is Sri Lanka, is seen in Sri Lanka and not anywhere else. So we have not exported our strain as well. And so this is the sequencing we have done so far in different parts of the country. So we only started with Colombo initially, but when the need came up, we have sequenced from Avisarella, Palutara, Gampaha, and Markale and Vaunia. And as you can see from this family tree, all of these viruses, even in Markale, Vaunia, Palutara, Gampaha, are children of the same parents. Okay, so and are of this viral strain. So with this, we know that it is the same viral strain, which is our viral strain, that has spread everywhere in Sri Lanka. But it's also important to do mutational analysis because certain mutations have no significance. Most mutations have no significance at all, but certain mutations increase the transmissibility of a virus and may increase the virulence of a virus. And now we know that actually if these mutations affect where the neutralizing antibodies bind to, they may affect vaccine efficacy. So we have been looking at our viral strains, and one of the mutations that emerged very early around April globally was this D614G mutation, which was subsequently seen in Sri Lankan strains. And this mutation was associated with higher transmissibility, and of course the higher transmissibility virus would replace the virus which is less fit to transmit. So that is just natural evolution. And with time, of course, the UK B.1.17 virus has a different mutation, which is more transmissible, which is also seen in the so-called South African strain, the so-called Brazilian strain. And so the current viruses are even more fit than this D614G virus variant to spread. In our strain, we have this unique mutation, H1159 mutation, which is in the spike protein, but is insignificant because it's just in a particular region of the spike protein, doesn't affect anything. So you don't really need to worry about other viral variants at all. Then with time, we have seen some new intruders. We saw the UK viral strain, but that is nothing, just one person. But recently we detected this, I think it was in news yesterday for some reason, this strain which was identified in a quarantine camp in Vaunia. So 44 individuals who came from a particular country had this variant. As you can see, the red ones are the three viruses we sequenced. So they are of this particular B.1.258 variant, which is seen in Denmark, Switzerland, Germany, those countries. It is not very bad, but it does have one more particular mutation which increases spread. So, but it is in individuals, it is a quarantine facility, and we did not detect it in the community. So, now just to understand the implications of this all this. So the current community strain which we are seeing doesn't seem to be a bad strain. It is unique to Sri Lanka, and either it was introduced, some virus was introduced to Sri Lanka, I don't know, August or September, mutated, and we have this our own strain, or whether it was some other strain which was hidden in the community and subsequently mutated, that we have our own strain now and that led to rapid spread, we don't know. So far, based on our sequencing data, we have sequenced viruses from various parts of the country until 3rd week of January, and this is what we see. We do see certain mutations emerging in our own strains. So as long as we keep the epidemic under control in Sri Lanka, we will not see nasty strains emerging. So far, our strains do not have any mutations that would affect vaccine efficacy. So I would like to thank everybody. Although I just talked about this, so many other people contribute to all the work we are doing. And for the sequencing, it's the WHO who funded all the sequencing and have committed to fund our sequencing, which we are supposed to do throughout the year, especially with the opening of the airports. We might see nasty intruders coming into the country. Okay, right, thank you.